something. Yeah, so thank you very much for the kind invitation. And in a way, where is Joseph still here? Yeah, in a way, this lecture fights against your lecture. in the style, certainly, but also in the results. So somehow, maybe not. Okay. So let me. So there are several chapters in the lectures. So let us start with stratifications. So the general assumption is that. But of course, very rapidly we will cut down the assumptions to something more more smaller. So X is just Noetherian over perfect field. And for the lecture, the characteristic will be P. And then one knows how to define, in fact, Grothendieck defines the infinitesimal site. And you know how it is done. Objects are just thickenings of Zariski opens here. And thickenings means that the this is closed in T, and the ideal is nilpotent. And we know in our day it's even more interesting to look at the crystalline site. Unfortunately, the questions which are behind what I explain, I cannot answer any of those. So I stay here on the infinitesimal sites. And the morphism respects the structures. And then one defines the category coherent infinitesimal of X as being the category of coherent crystals on these sites. And Saavedra showed, so Saavedra. He showed that assuming X is connected, that this category is Tanakian, in fact, so it's Tanakian over K if, yeah, it's over K. Maybe one should assume that X is geometrically connected, so maybe I should say this. I'm not quite sure here. Okay, anyhow. And then, of course, one can neutralize this category by fixing a rational point, if it has a rational point, so we better assume it's geometrically connected. So we fix a rational point, and this defines a fiber functor to the vector space over K by assigning to any crystal here the restriction of the coherent shift on X here at A. And of course, in this statement here, it contains a statement, and in fact, it's one of the main statements here, is that any object here is in fact a vector bundle, it's locally free. Yes. It's automatically locally free, and this is exactly the same statement if X is smooth. Yeah. So this is precisely this. And then there's another category which is which you can define in a natural way. This is a category of F divided shifts. So. So we can also define the category of F divided shifts here. By this is a category, so the objects are sequences EI sigma I, where EI is coherent on the Frobenius twist. So this is a relative here notion on the Frobenius twist of X over K. So this is Frobenius twist. And the sigma I identify EI with a relative Frobenius pullback of EI plus 1. And the Morphis respects this thing. And then this is also a Tanakian category. And the main point here is really to see that the objects are locally free. And one can observe, and I made this observation with Srinivas, but probably it's earlier, so observe. That if we assume in addition K to be perfect, then there is a functor from F divided shifts. Shifts means coherent shift here. To Saavedra's category. And here also, I should in fact also write relative to K. And we will see in a second that it plays no role, this relative to K, is because whenever we have a thickening here, an element in an object in the site, so we have an infinitesimal thickening of an open, we can always dominate it by a high power of the absolute Frobenius. So on the other hand, because K is perfect, the data of all those vector bosons Frobenius descents, relative Frobenius descent, are equivalent on object to data of absolute Frobenius descent. So that gives a value whenever we have a F divided shift here, we can assign here a Saavedra object, a crystal in the infinitesimal site. And it's a very nice observation of Bhargav Bhatt that in fact it is an equivalence of category. And he argues like this. It's not very difficult, but it's a very elegant formulation. He argues like this, that in the fiber product, so we can, for example, take the fiber product of X over FP. And then in this fiber product, we have delta P, XP, which is defined as the fiber product over the absolute Frobenius. So let's say, let us call here, I call it X1, X0, X1. This is the absolute Frobenius. And this is the fiber product. And then we can go to the formal completion here. So let's say we have the formal completion here. And notice that if we take the formal completion here, this is the same as the formal completion over K. And here we have the two projections. And then it doesn't yet. So that means in part, so when we have a crystal here, then we have a value of this crystal on this infinitesimal thickening here. So as a corollary, we have the value of the crystal here on this specific thickening here. So if X was smooth or regular, then the fact that this infinitesimal thickening here, the value of the crystal is identified with the pullback of the value on the two factors, will give us here descent, because F is flat. And this gives a Frobenius descent. So this Frobenius will be the absolute Frobenius. And then again, we use the fact that the ground field is perfect, so we pass from absolute Frobenius descent to a relative Frobenius descent. And in general, if X is not regular, then we make use of the crystal property here of the object. So in general, one can replace X by embed X in V, V regular, and then replace X by the formal completion of X along V, and then do the same thing. So this is a sort of introduction here to the objects we are going to look at. And now we come to Patrick's question. So if X is smooth over K, so this is the theorem of Katz. If X is smooth over K, this category here. So in fact, we showed more here. So assume K is perfect. Then we had this equivalence of category here. And in fact, we can put FP here. And this category here is equivalent to the category of O-coherent D X over K modules, which is of course the same as DF over FP module. So this is by Cartier descent here. Okay, so now the general question, and that brings us back a tiny little bit to Joseph, is I need one more very general information here to make sense of the question. And this is the theorem of Dos Santos, which says the following. It says two things. So we assume now that K is algebraically closed. So otherwise, I have to talk a lot to say not much. And then it is true. So all those categories are Tanakian. So for short, fixing As we said already at the beginning, fixing a rational point defines a group scheme, an affine group scheme. And now I just write it like this for Frobenius here. And I don't write the best point here. It plays no role in the discussion. So the first thing one can say, in fact, I should... it's not the center. This is, in fact, an easy observation here, is that... Once the ground field is algebraically closed here, so in general, I can look at the profinite completion of this group scheme here. And if K is algebraically closed, this is just the étale fundamental group thought of as a constant group scheme here over K bar. So this is very easy to see. And you see that the profinite completion here is, in particular, pro-smooth. So there's no nilpotent part like in the fundamental group scheme of Madame Nouri. And more generally, Dos Santos shows that the PF here is pro-smooth. So it makes sense to ask, what is the relationship between the two? So in the sense of conservativity, as you were asking in your question. So, and the reason why one raises this question is an historical one. This is a theorem of Maltsev and Grothendieck over C, so analogy over C. Then we have the theorem of Maltsev and Grothendieck, which is saying that if so X is now, so it's over C, I will assume that it is a finite type and maybe normal, otherwise, well, it doesn't really matter, in fact, so let's just assume normal. And then if the étale fundamental group of X is trivial, then there are no non-trivial regular singular connections. So, and the reason for this, I have explained always the same statement here. It's easy, you can retrieve that by yourself using, so this is a corollary of the fact that this whole situation is controlled by the topological fundamental group. And this topological fundamental group is a finite type. It's finitely generated. In fact, it's even more than this, but in order to prove this, one uses only this, this proposition here. So then the corresponding statement here, at least part of the statement in characteristic P, is the following. So theorem with meta is that if X is proper over K algebraically closed of characteristic P, and if its étale fundamental group is trivial, then PF is trivial as well. So the proof is complicated and long, and I will not discuss anything now because we will go on and we will see where we can tie up to this. But to be honest, we prove this under the assumption that X is projective and smooth. But Bhargav, discussing what I said earlier on here, in fact, observes that the same proof, word by word, applies to the whole the category of crystals in the infinitesimal sites, or the category of F-divided shifts. We just saw that this is the same. So extension, so observe. It's okay, like this. So this means that there is more information, but in some sense, there is not much more information. So, of course, it leaves open what is the analogy, the complete analogy to the complex geometry here. We can raise two questions, and I will address only one. It's not because of lack of time, it's just because I cannot address the second one. So two natural questions is that extend this, so extend theorem to X not proper in the following shape. So assume the étale fundamental group is trivial. Is it the case that the stratified fundamental group is trivial? So this is what I will address as a question. And the second question, which I will not address, but which is perhaps even more interesting, is this just because I don't have method so far to understand it, is it extends the theorem to X non-proper. So maybe I should say smooth here for simplicity, but maybe one should get out of smooth because we just saw that the category behaves very well, and this gives more methods to attack it. And here, but here in the second part, here I really need smooth. And then I replace the fundamental group here by the theme fundamental group, as, for example, studied in details by Kurtz and Schmidt. And here, one replaces the stratified fundamental group by the fundamental group of the full subcategory, which consists of regular singular objects. And this question here does make sense because Kindler proved that the profinite completion, if X is smooth, the profinite completion of this group here, the profinite completion of this group here is exactly this theme fundamental group. But he defines it. So in case if we had a good, if we had resolution of singularities at disposal, so then regular singular would be X is smooth. So we think of the problem in the category of D modules. And then regular singular has a similar definition as the one defined by Deligne. Over the complex numbers, which has been also analyzed by Giesecke. And I should say that this theorem here, the main theorem which was on the board somewhere, is an answer to a conjecture by Giesecke. Now, if X is still smooth, but we don't know it has a regular singular. We don't know it has a good compactification, I apologize. One first goes back to the work of Deligne, which showed that regular singular over the field of complex numbers is equivalent to saying that it is true on any curve over which we have a good compactification. And then the work of Moritz Kurtz shows the same thing for the theme fundamental groups. That means, with this inspiration, Lars Kindler defined regular singular in any generality by restriction to curves. Okay, so this is the same thing. So now let me show you the theorem we want to discuss. To make sense to act, yeah. This is precisely what he does for all differential operators, yeah. This is precisely this, and then the challenge is with this definition to show that the profinite if you have a D module in this occurrence D module with this property. That to have finite monodromy is the same as coming from a theme fundamental group. That means the corresponding torsor has to be theme. So that is a challenge. Okay, so now we address question one. And then we will address question one, and so we can answer partly question one, but there are plenty of questions which we cannot, to which we cannot give an answer. So the theorem is like this. So this is theorem two, so to speak. And there are two constraints, two assumptions, unfortunately. So, in fact, at the time we were thinking of this, I hadn't thought yet. I mean, Bargav hadn't told me that all those categories are equivalent, even if X was not smooth. So I was thinking only for smooth variety here. But I think for what I will present here, it is quite necessary, unfortunately. So we assume, so let x hat, so k is as usual, because we don't do any arithmetics here, k can be taken to be algebraically closed of characteristic p. And x hat to be a normal projective variety. So we, in fact, this will it comes immediately over. So the k bar here will be f p bar. So this is obviously a restriction here, and the second restriction is of geometric nature. Let j x in x hat to be the regular locus, or the smooth is the same thing here. And we assume that the boundary closed subscheme here has codimension at least two. So it is a strong assumption. But we will see that already something of high interest is happening here. Then the conclusion is that question one has a positive answer. So question one, of course, sorry. You're right. Thank you very much. So, but okay, then maybe okay, you are completely right. I'm not focused. Thank you very much. So assume P1 etal of x is 1. So that is a strong assumption. Then which is buried here, which is hidden in the first question we are raising here, it's the case that if the Ital fundamental group is trivial, then there are no crystals in the infinitesimal site. And of course, you may argue that there are not that many varieties in characteristic P which have a trivial fundamental group and which are not proper, and we will come to this at the end. I will give examples and questions. But before we do that, we can explain abstractly what is behind, because it is touching. So as was already mentioned, in the proper case, I mean, the main point is that in characteristic zero, all those questions are easily understood for the simple reason that we can always go to the field of complex numbers, and once we are there, then we have the topological fundamental group, and this one is finitely generated. So that means this is the main reason why in characteristic zero, those questions are easily understood. But then, of course, in characteristic P, we don't have that at all. We don't have any replacement for this. And now I'm going to explain how one can think of a replacement for this. Okay. So the next section here is called here. So now we will discuss this theorem here. So the next section here is boundedness. So recall that over C, then this fundamental fact here that pi 1 topological is a finite tap shows that there's a moduli of, for example, representations of, and in fact it's affine, but that is not important. The main point here that affine implies finite type representation of the topological fundamental group in bounded rank. So let's say A. And using this, then Delin showed Delin showed that so using this topological finiteness, Delin showed that the set of Chern classes of all the Delin extensions of all regular singular rank R connections, algebraic flat connections, so you take all possible regular singular bundles or connections of rank R or at most R. From those you take the Delin extensions. In fact, one can weaken this extension, but let's say the Delin extension. And from those, one considers the Chern classes in the Hodge cohomology of the compactification. And then the statement is that this set here is finite. So this is a consequence of this property of the topological fundamental group. And in fact, one can deduce this from Takuro Mochizuki's work. Which is purely analytic. So this proof here is topological. This proof is analytic. And in fact, one can even give an algebraic proof, which is not yet written. And I don't explain. And this is a computation which we did with Adrian Langer. So this is a support to think that what I'm going to write on the board here is correct. It's not a proof, of course, but it's a support. Even though on the right-hand side here, we don't know, in fact, whether we deal with objects which are regular singular. So the theorem is like this. So this is in the work with Srinivas. The theorem is that we fix one for all a non-pole Cartier divisor. So let y hat to x hat a non-pole Cartier divisor. So we fix it. Then there are finitely many polynomials. Let's say chi I M with Q coefficients and variable M such that for any F divided coherent shift, so coherent bundle, so for any F divided, so coherent shift means bundles because we know those are bundles of rank, let's say at most R. Then when we look at this Frobenius descent here, we have the first vector bundle E0, the second one E1, and so forth. Then when we go deep enough, so such that there is an N0, which depends on E, such that for any N at least N0, then the Hilbert polynomial of, so the Hilbert polynomial, so chi on x hat of j lower star en, measured with this given ample class here, is one of those chi I. So it's quite remarkable. So this is really the analogy to this theorem, is that we look at all those f divided shifts. So we have plenty of f divided shifts. We have plenty of objects. And then, so here of course we have no, just x hat is normal here. That's the only assumption. And this is it's a sort of analog to the theorem here. Is that, clearly we cannot have that all the Hilbert polynomial can lie in a finite set if we consider all the F division. Because once we have an object, we can always take the Frobenius inverse of the zeros factor. And so what we can say is that whatever object we take, if we go deep enough in the F division, then there are only finitely many Hilbert polynomials. So it's a quite profound thing here. And the proof is, in fact, quite not so completely easy. So the proof relies on two fundamental facts. The first one is that this kind of statement can be reduced to surfaces. So then we have a normal surface. We have finitely many points at infinity. And then we have to do a very careful analysis of Chern classes in blow-ups of all those vector bundles at once. And we were inspired to do that, this difficult computation, by an earlier work by Adrian Langer. He computes something different, but part of the methods we use are inspired by his method, so partly here. And then on surfaces, on normal surfaces, use one ID of Adrian Langer. So clearly, I don't say that. Pardon me? Yeah, we felt because we are on the surface now, we do have this angle. That's the main thing. Otherwise, we could argue directly in higher dimension. But in higher dimension, we don't have this angularization, so it makes very hard. And on the surface, we strongly use that the divisor it's negative definite. And this is part of the idea here. Okay, so this is one thing. And then, and I will come to. What time is it? It's okay. Pardon me? 20 minutes? It's okay. Oh, no, it's maybe not okay. But in fact, I lose my mind here because I lose the. Okay. So the second part, so this is boundedness here. We are here. Chern class, yeah, this is we no longer have Betty Komodi at disposal, so thank you very much for the question. So we look at, for C1, we look at degree on an ample curve. And for C2, we just look at degrees because we're on the surface. So those are so I could say, for short, in higher dimension, we would say numerical Chern classes. Of course, we could recognize this in Eladi Komodi, but that's not the way we do. Okay, so the second part here, so this is first part of the proof. Second part is Lefschetz theorem. The proof is really, it's quite hard, in fact. So now we have a very recent theorem of Jean-Benoît Bost. And in fact, he proved it because I mean, it was not pre-proved, so to speak. I kindly asked him to prove that, because he obviously he had the method to prove this. So this is a theorem of Jean-Benoît Bost, which is an improved, not left effective, but left theorem. And for bundles. But in fact, the proof he does uses a sort of left theorem for schemes and not bundles, and in addition, some Bertini theorem, a version which is true in characteristic P. So the situation is like this. So we keep the same notation. So let Y, so I don't put a hat here, in X hat here. And we assume that that this is smooth projective and lies in X, which is possible by our assumption. We will always have one such curve here. So Y should be sort of intersection with the correct number here of HI, I apologize, which is ample. So this is the assumption. And we assume that we have a vector bundle. So I apologize, my notation is, okay. I will take the completion along Y, so it's not very elegant. So if E hat here is a vector bundle on the completion of X hat along Y. Which is algebraizable. On open of X hat, then all subs and quotients of E hat are algebraizable. So that means if we take a genuine vector bundle on X hat, we restrict it to Y. On X, I should say on X, because Y is in X. We restrict it to Y. We look at the formal completion, and then we look at sub and quotients of those. They are still algebraic. So now, the corollary of Jean-Benoît's theorem here is that if we take a Y, there is always such a Y, which is a curve here. So in our situation here, one has, so for a Y as in the left theorem, then crystalline fundamental group here in the sense we discussed earlier on receives surjectively the crystalline fundamental group of this Y. And this will play an important role in the proof. Some problem? It contains Y, yeah. Like in SGA 2, I think. Okay. So now, how much time do I have? I wonder whether, maybe I have no time. So I apologize. I have prepared then a sketch. So maybe I should say, of course, it's not very honest not to enter into the details, but let me say, okay, those are the geometric theorems which are behind. And because I'm running out of time, and I apologize for this, let me tell you the following, is that, so we use this theorem here So on the proof, we use this theorem here to say the following. So we are on our variety here, and we have an object, and we know they are recognized on this one curve, y. And then, in particular, we know that on y is smooth and projective, so there is a notion of stability, which is used all the time. That means we have, when we start with an object on x, we restrict on y. So we have all those vector bundles on y. And then we know, I had computed this in the theorem in the projective case with meta, that any such object here, as an object, when we go deep enough, maybe not the object itself, but if we discard finitely many information, then what remains is a successive extension of stratified objects like this, such that all the underlying vector bundles are stable of turn classes zero. And so then we can do this argument here and reduce, because we have this surjectivity here, so we are reduced to the case where our object is has the property that it is stable. All the underlying vector bundles are stable on this curve, and consequently, when we take J lower star of those, this yield stable objects, coherent objects on X, because the notion of stability is just defined like this for sheaves which are not vector bundles. You define stability by restriction to a curve where they are vector bundles. So that means we work with moduli on X hat. So thanks to this surjectivity here, we can work with moduli points. And those moduli points correspond to the J lower star En on X hat. And then on them, again, we have this action of Frobenius, which is just rational on the subscheme, which is spanned by all those moduli points. So we have the assignment, which to an En assigns Frobenius pullback of En, defines some rational map. Rational dominant map on the subscheme, which is essentially the Zariski closure of all the subjects. Of all those points, not object, I apologize. And here, so what we want is a fixed point of those, because a fixed point, so if we have a fixed point, and this is like the old proof in the projective case, so if we have, so look for a fixed point. Because if this fixed point was taking place exactly on the locus where this map is really defined, this would just define for us a vector bundle on X now, not on X hat, with a property that its Frobenius pullback is isomorphic to itself, or some power of the Frobenius pullback is isomorphic to itself. And such an equation is a sort of non-commutative Artin-Schreier equation, or one can also say non-commutative Kummer extension. It defines a covering over which this bundle trivializes. And then, if we assume that the Ethal fundamental group is trivial, this covering is trivial, that means the bundle itself is trivial. So that means the J lower star of all those bundles are trivial. And then, because of the geometry here, to trivialize the vector bundle algebraically is enough to trivialize the object as a crystal. So we look for a fixed point, and here, this is where we use that the ground field is FP bar, because in order to find this fixed point, we use a theorem which is coming from a theorem of Ruchowski. which is a theorem only for varieties defined over the algebraic closure of a finite field. Unfortunately, this theorem is proven by model theory, and it's very difficult to read. But fortunately, just a few months ago, Warshawski produced an extremely beautiful proof. So this is really a proof in the framework of arithmetic geometry. It's really a fantastic proof, and I invite anyone here to look at it in details, because there are lots of very beautiful details. So this proof here gives us the existence of a fixed point, and this is the end of the story. So let me now comment and give so the end of the proof here is like in the proper case, but in the middle here, it's really quite difficult. So why? So maybe I should start with this here. We could, in the proper case, there is no such restriction on the ground field here, but here we have to make a restriction. And the reason is because one would like to, whenever we are over a larger field here, one would like to specialize the situation to a smaller field, and then argue on the smaller field, and then come back to the original field. And so this strategy was successful over proper varieties for the following reason, is because we have at disposal Grothendieck specialization homomorphism. So here I say comment on FP bar. So we have Grothendieck specialization homomorphism, P1 X K bar to P1 X, let's say little K bar with obvious notations here, under the assumption that X is proper. And if X is not proper, then if X is proper and one takes really a good specialization here, so for example, smooth, or it's more general than this, then it is surjective. And then the assumption on the Ethal fundamental group here carries over to any good specialization here. But if X is not proper, the only theorem we have at disposal on specialization is for the TEM fundamental group. And in fact, at the time it was written, people didn't really look at TEM. They look at the P prime quotient of the fundamental group, which is weaker information than the TEM fundamental group. So they could, for good specialization here, there is, so this is in SGA, this is due to Madame Reynaud, and there is such a specialization here. And then one can hope that the method here generalized to really the TEM fundamental group. But here we deal with the whole fundamental group, and I don't know how to specialize. The assumption, how to specialize pi 1, etal of x. I mean, to find a specialization for which I can specialize the fundamental group. So in fact, I discussed Joseph. I discussed with Joseph some months ago on this, but it doesn't look so easy. So not any specialization will do it. And so, yeah, it looks quite difficult. So this is the reason why one cannot generalize here, at least in the present state of knowledge, to a more general field than FP bar. So this was one comment. So now there's another comment. Is that maybe the most profound theorem, which is in what I explain, is not too much the theorem itself, but this is this boundedness theorem. So let me comment on the boundedness, and let me come back to the field of complex numbers. Because finally here, so in characteristic P, we don't really look at regular singular objects. Maybe they are regular singular, but I don't know. I mean, those we deal with here.
Is there some notion of like residues when you have a regular singular
For regular singular, yes, there's a residue. You can read the last thesis. He defined, in fact, the residues were defined by Katz before. The residues themselves are periodic integers, in periodic numbers, in fact, not even integers. They are periodic numbers, and they are defined in this thesis. That is a question which I cannot answer so far. I can do for C1. For C1, I can express the first chain class numerically in terms of those residues. But so far, I was not able, and in fact, I stopped on this approach here to generalize the formula one has in characteristic zero out of the residue of regular singular connection. One can retrieve all the Hodge classes. And here, I don't know the answer to this question. Yeah, so I can show that if I take the trace of the residue and the sum of all of those, this is minus the first chain class numerically. This is true. But for the deeper chain classes, I'm not quite sure how to express that, because degree numerically, so one should look at numerical chain classes, and right now I was not able to relate them to those periodic numbers. Okay? But let me show you a stronger boundedness, which is quite surprising. This is like this. So I come back to boundedness over C. And here is a following proposition. And maybe after that, in fact, I wanted to talk also on Totaro's work, but I don't. So, okay, I finish here with this thing. So assume we are over C and we have a normal crossing divisor situation. And now I'm looking now at irregular connections. That means I'm looking at all in un blanc on X. And then we know, so meromorphic connection, we know by the work of Malgrange, Kedlaya, and Mochizuki, there is a notion here of a, let me write here, Deligne, Malgrange, Kedlaya, Mochizuki. There is a notion of such a lattice. So this lattice will be a vector bundle on X hat. And then we can bound the rank. So let's say rank R is given. And now I'm going to bound two things. The first thing is that we give ourselves a blow up. So let's say F from Y hat to X hat here is, so let me assume dimension 2 because boundedness is a question dimension 2, and otherwise it's more complicated to express. So y hat to x hat is just a successive blow-ups of points. So this is bar rational, and y hat is smooth, and this is proper. So bar rational proper, and it's smooth. So we fix this. And then we fix, we assume, so we are looking at all in un blanc of rank, let's say R, on X, such that on Y, there is no turning point. Now we fix the irregularity along each branch of the divisor at infinity, so let's say di. Then we bound irregularity of in un blanc along the generic point of each di. And then the conclusion is that all those chain classes, so let's say chain, of those Deligne, Malgrange, Kedlaya, Mochizuki lattices viewed as classes, for example, in Betti cohomology. This is a finite set. The goal being, of course, later on, if the program is successful, to construct moduli for those. The turning point is it's a notion which has been defined by Mochizuki and Kedlaya independently. When we have a higher rank connection, irregular, but on a curve, and more generally, we don't need the residue field to be perfect to argue, then we have the Turitin-Levelt decomposition, which is telling us that after a finite ramification, there is a standard expression for this connection. So now this theorem in higher dimension is no longer true. If I fix a point at infinity, it is not the case that after finite ramification, I will have a good shape, a canonical shape. Canonical shape means the direct sum of regular singular tensor characters, which are irregular. That is canonical shape. So direct sum of regular singular tensor characters. And characters are locally defined by exact differentials of functions with poles. So this is not the case. But it is the case that after finitely many blow-ups, so it's itself a finiteness theorem, after finitely many blow-ups at infinity, then it will be the case that once we go there, we have eliminated those turning points in quotation marks. That means saying that we kill the turning points, it is saying that locally, formally, at each point at infinity, there will be a covering, finite covering, over which we will have a standard shape. And now the theorem is that once we fix this y on which it happens, then nothing more happens than for the regular singular case. And in fact, what I believe, but I'm not yet able to prove it completely, is that once we have eliminated the turning points, then the chain classes of the Delisle-Malgrange blah-blah lattice is the same. And you will not love this because there is a very strange correspondence here. It's the same as the chain classes of the Deligne extension of the underlying regular singular connection. Yeah, I know I didn't want to say, but because you ask, I think that's going to be the upshot of the story. Because I can show that for in the case where we have this canonical decomposition. I mean, assume I no longer need ramification. Then I can show that the chain classes of this Deligne-Malgrange connection is the same as the chain classes of the Deligne extension of the underlying regular singular connection. So this is very bizarre, but those things happen. Okay. Pardon me? Well, that means I have a connection, so I have a local system, and from it I take, Yeah, so this is a very analytic correspondence here. But chain classes do not see that too much. So, okay, so I have no time to talk on examples, nice examples of simply connected varieties in characteristic P, and how to relate that to the work of Bertotaro. So I stop here. Thank you very much for your attention.